Good afternoon. I'm really glad to be here sharing my research with you and within the colloquium series promoted by the High School at the University of Toronto. As a regard, I want to say thanks to Kelly Lyons and Siobhan Stevenson for having invited me and all of you to be here today. As you can hear, my English is not so good, and I apologize for it. Even so, I will do my best. Let me start from a picture. This picture. It's a work of the Italian Renaissance. It is attributed to Francesco Di Giorgio Martini, a painter and architect who lived in Siena, in Italy, of course, near Florence. The work belongs to the series of Ideal City. I can show you some paintings at the same period. This one, Ideal City 2. This one, Ideal City. Go back to the first one. The exact title is Ideal View of Fantastic City. As you can see, this is a perfect example of the Renaissance perspective. But it also shows a vision of the world. This kind of picture, this imaginary city, is also an expression of a new concept of urban life, a new way of looking, the Renaissance looking. Therefore, we can say that in this picture merge a new technical and artistic knowledge, the perspective, with an historical point of view, a specific vision of the world, typical of Renaissance. So, during this lesson and this lecture, we will again see this picture. And it will be a little surprise that at the moment I cannot reveal. For now, it's important to use this picture to introduce and explain the title of this lecture. I'm referring explicitly to Erwin Panofsky's work published in 1927. As you know, Panofsky was a German art historian, well known for his work titled The Perspective as Symbolic Form. Well, in this my research, I try to understand that if it's possible to develop a thesis on the situation of contemporary visual culture that renew the one proposed by Panofsky. I try to prove that it is indeed possible. Of course, it's necessary updating the notion of perspective. Even better, finding a replacement is necessary. Finding a new symbolic form better suited to the contemporary age at the moment. Let's try. I know each new word, each neologism is irritating, but sometimes, without a lot of it, of course, neologisms can be semantic tools to build or prove a certain case. Therefore, please give me the chance to use a neologism. Such neologism I will use is video morphosis. Video, from a Latin word to see, to look, to watch, but also to find. In the etymology of the word video, we can find something like to see with the eyes of mind, that sound like understanding. Morphosis instead comes from the Greek word morphe, that means form, but also the essence, the matter. Well, I think it's clear I will be using in this context video morphosis in order to validate the assumption that video is now the prevailing symbolic form of contemporary visual culture. In my view, it is the symbolic form best suited to represent a quintessential stylistic moment of current visual culture, where a stylistic moment is the exact expression used by Panofsky, stylistic moment. At this point, I know it is necessary better define the term video. So we should describe it as a device, a technological device, of course, but also a foremost a cultural device acting in the relation that exists between humankind and the world. As a device, video could be defined as an aesthetic device in its own meaning, so as a way of feeling and perceiving the world, an extension of human sensory network, the sensorium, as conceived by Marshall McLuhan, with a consequent feedback effect on humans and their vision of the world, their understanding of the world. That is what the 20th century continental philosophy has defined by the German term Weltanschauung. Weltanschauung, that means just the vision of the world, also ideology. So, a technological and cultural device with an aesthetics value is nothing but a medium. But as symbolic form, or video morphosis in this context, video can be perceived also as a meta-medium, a system of expressive form, a seamless media surface shared by different material and intellectual components that shape the entire contemporary cultural system. Think about it. Cinema, broadcasting TV, personal computer, portable device and smartphone, as well as video games or any kind of display disseminated across the urban space, today, everything is video. So, we have different media as well as different languages, but a lot of this media sharing the video form. All of them work within the video morphosis process. Not coincidentally, the video prefix is common to many expressions of the daily language, such as video games, video phone, video surveillance, etc. Where video always stands for images shaped by movement, with which we interact in some way. Moreover, all of these screens form a carousel of images flowing in a single visual stream, an unstoppable and fluid visual continuum, a form of exchange, relation, interaction between viewer and objects. For example, Nicolas Mirzoeff, professor of media, culture and communication at New York University, has defined this continuum of images as a visual event. Others have created for this phenomenon even more neologisms, such as video sphere, the French Regis Debré, or Video Scale, the Italian Massimo Canovacci, etc. So, why it's important the assumption of video as a symbolic form? It's important because it reveals the relationship that always exists between symbolic culture, even known as hype culture, and material culture, even known as technological culture. So, finding this relationship, achieving this connection, represent one of the most important legacy of Marshall McLuhan, as well as thinking in terms of video, gives us the opportunity to explore this perceptive stream, this continuum, this visual event, video sphere, videoscape, or whatever name you want, in order to understand how our culture is evolving. So, the process I call video morphosis is, after all, the result of convergence of the technology of vision conceived over the ages, that today takes on a new symbolic value, and therefore creates a new way of looking, a new vision, a new understanding of the world. So, we can sum up with an equation. New visual devices equal new understanding of the world. Think about it. New visual devices, new visual tools, as a new welcome sham, a new vision of the world. In other terms, I want to summarize that we are what we see. Our visual tools affect our vision of the world. Therefore, if we understand and explore our visual scale, we can better understand who we are. I will go back on these questions. Now, let's see what Panofsky said about the notion of the symbolic form. First of all, it derives from the so-called German Marburger School and its main thinker, Ernest Cassirer. Let's read what Panofsky wrote. Perspective may even be characterized, to extend Ernest Cassirer's Felicitous term to the history of art, as one of those symbolic forms in which spiritual meaning is attached to a concrete material sign and intrinsically given to this sign. In this way, a spiritual meaning, a supersensible meaning, in other terms, an high cultural fact, becomes sensible, becomes a material sign that can be experienced, becomes a technological fact. So, the symbolic form has the specific advantage of reconnecting the sensible, etymologically aesthetic component of the material culture to the supersensible or symbolic spiritual component pertaining to the realm of ideas, concepts, thoughts, and culture, or culture tout court, to use a French term, culture tout court. For this reason, perspective space, or in Panofsky's words, an intuition of real space, is not just a visual process. Perspective is not just a visual process, but it is also a cultural device that connects the material dimension of Renaissance to the corresponding symbolic dimension of Renaissance. At the same time, the perspective space amplifies the potential of both. And also it affects the entire season of humankind, we know as modern age. Even better, perspective is strongly connected with the vision of the world in the modern age. It's not just a technical visual process. Okay? Look at this picture. Think about it. Perspective becomes the expression of a vision of the world in the modern age. And at the same time, perspective affects the vision of the world in the modern age. So if we accept that this symbolic rule of the perspective within the modern age, there is probably a similar device playing the same rule in relation with the contemporary age. In this sense, there could be no better device, no better symbolic form, no better synthesis of conception and perception than the video. So, much more than a technical device, and so defining in its specific linguistic features. And there could be no better replacement of the perspective vision than the kind of vision we may define as videomorphic, or videomorphical vision. So in order to provide evidence for this assumption, I will now show some functional points in common shared by the perspective vision and the videomorphic vision, as well as some differences that may support the rule of a video as a symbolic form for the contemporary age. In other words, I will compare briefly the perspective and videomorphic cultures, perspective and videomorphic vision. Starting from the functional points in common, it's important to note that both perspective and videomorphic vision share a similar technological dimension. As maybe you know, even the most up-to-date digital devices, cameras, scanners, video, photo, used by all of us, are based on the whole principle of camera obscura, at least as old as perspective. Look, did you never try it? Yes, it's funny. Camera obscura was already used by artists in the early 15th century, and its principles were known since the time of the ancient Chinese philosopher Nietzsche or Aristotle. The difference today is that the optical light signals challenged in one focal point are transformed in electromagnetic impulses and then codified in the system of digital representation. But essentially, sharing the same basic principle that lead to the invention first of photography and then of cinema. In the case of traditional photography and cinema, these signals are fixed on film rather than on the electromagnetic devices called CCD, used by digital products. Also, we should not forget that even the more up-to-date techniques for 3D simulation and modeling are essentially based on perspective rules and principles. Look at this picture.
we have the perspective ideal city and a rendering 3D. After all, what appears evident is the common dimension shared by old and new technologies of vision. A principle rooted in the governing and rationalizing impulse typical of modern age. The fundamental difference is that while the perspective representation of modern age is based on the artist's painterly manual skill, with the invention of photography, this process becomes mechanized, automatized, relying on the intrinsic possibilities of the technical devices. Therefore, within the current technologies of vision, there is an element of continuity with the past, the camera oscura, that should not be forgotten. Even the most refined techniques of digital image processing may be interpreted as nothing but a sort of electronic painting. So we can say that a further element of continuity between perspective and videomorphic vision is to be found in what Lev Manovich, professor of media studies at the University of California, calls a general tendency of the Western screen-based culture, screen-based representational apparatus. In fact, the screen, viewed as an interface of the videomorphic vision, as well as a technical device, is well suited to represent an up-to-date version of the powerful metaphor conceived during the Renaissance, that is the metaphor of the frame, the metaphor of the window. Just a funny picture. Sometimes window and problem. Well, let's go on. A further point in common related to the cultural substrate that lead to the birth of both perspective form and video form, each in its particular historical context, is the fact that both express themselves as transdisciplinary forms. They are the result of the intersection, the convergence, and exchange of several disciplines and skills belonging to the technical scientific realm, as much as to the art humanities realm, and deriving from the concerted effort of artists, philosophers, engineers, scientists, mathematician. Jonathan Crary, professor of modern art and theory at the Columbia University in New York, suggests, for example, that optical devices such the camera oscura and the stereoscope are points of intersection where philosophical, scientific, and aesthetic discourses overlap with mechanical techniques, institutional requirements, and socio-economic forces. In all these cases, they are not one-off invention, but the result of a shared need to express a new vision of the world. This is made clear by a series of close collaboration between the arts and science field. So, Panofsky defined the perspective as an intuition of real space as the result of coincidence of aesthetic taste and the particularly Italian synergy between the world of science, think about Leon Battista Salverti's rationalist geometric mathematic vision, and the world of art, the rule of Florentine innovators, Brunelleschi, Donatello, Masaccio, Piero della Francesca. In the same way, a similar process take place in the era of the early experiments about video. In this regard, we should not forget that video technology began with the scientific researches developed in Europe at the end of 19th century. I will show you these pictures. In these pictures we can see the electric telescope, the first electronic device that mechanically scanned moving images as many different dots. This device was patented just in 1884 by Nipkow, Paul Nipkow, a student in Berlin. So, from that moment onwards, the following technological development proceeded in parallel with the decision of Italian divisionism and French pointillism, two movements that, while belonging to the art field, first interpreted the same processes of breakdown and scanning of the image, visual and chromatic components underlying the video technology. Look, Joe Seurat, and this divisionist, pointillist kind of painting. A lot of pixel as a scanned picture. This is an example of the convergence of science and art in the history of the Western scientific thought. I think this convergence is really an important point in common between perspective and videomorphic vision. Now, let me move on to point out the difference between perspective and videomorphic cultures. A first important element can be found in the giving up, a going over the single point of view, as well as the renunciation of the perspective illusion. Yes, because perspective is just an illusion, guys. You wanna see an example? Look at these pictures. We have a perspective illusion. The third people seems more bigger than the first. Okay? But instead, they are equal. As well as the second ball is equal to the first ball. Many optical illusions are based on the illusion of the perspective space. So, going over the perspective illusion, leaving the perspective space is one of the most aims of cubism. A first thinker, Edmond Cuchot, among others, as remarked with reference to the ontological status of the electronic image, the expressive trend inaugurated by the Cubist school aimed at eliminating all kinds of optical perspective representation conveys the reflection of a more general cultural significance. The loss of perspective in the Cubism was the result of a wider aesthetic research driven by the need to penetrate the essence of things and present them in their fragmentary nature. Rejecting the rationalism and totalizing aspiration of the perspective culture, a single point of view, the art interventions performed in the context of Cubism shows the timely contemporary need for visual fragmentation, several point of view. The fragments, like the pieces of a mosaic or the faces of a cube, enable the explorative and cognitive dimension of the eye to form a coherent view of space. To pay homage to Cubism's conceptual heritage, what I have just described could be summarized by the antinomy between the so-called exogenous function of vision, the vision from outside, from its opposite, endogenous function, the vision from inside. And now I can finally reveal the little surprise I talked about previously. In his book, The Medium is the Massage, Marshall McLuhan quotes the picture of Ideal City I showed you before. That's fine. You remember? We can read the Renaissance Legacy, The Vanishing Point. The viewer of Renaissance art is systematically placed outside the frame of experience. A piazza for everything and everything in its piazza in the Renaissance. Today, the instantaneous world of electric informational media involves all of us, all at once. No detachment or frame is possible. Following this intellectual stimulation, we might say that contemporary visual culture is an expression of videomorphosis, of the endogenous function of vision, a vision from inside, no frames, no window. New kind of images appears to offer the viewer endless opportunities to get into the frame, in the sense that the visual experience today, with all its aesthetical implications, becomes an exploration rather than a simple interpretation. If the perspective culture belongs to the symbolic universe where space is narrated, portrayed or represented, videomorphosis transforms the symbolic universe into something that can be assessed, explored, interacted with. With regard to this, it's interesting to refer to Jonathan Crary's research on optical devices and techniques on the forms of visual imagery in the 19th century, and on the stereoscope in particular. Look. You did just right. It's fun. Jonathan Crary sees in the stereoscope the first tool that
began to express the activity of observation as an action, and more precisely, as a process of immersion in what one sees. A real merging of the viewer and the object. No other formal representation in the 19th century, Crary affirms, had so conflated the real with the optical, an object with its image. Therefore, the appearance of the stereoscope may represent the crucial moment of the passage from the real to the optical, or from an objective kind of vision that times giving order to reality, perspective vision, giving order to reality, to a subjective kind of vision that times at building forms of thought and knowledge not constrained or necessarily subjected to reality, videomorphic vision. So, let's go on with a further element of difference between perspective and videomorphic cultures that concerns the ontological status of the image itself as it is filtered, processed, mediated by a technological viewing device. In other words, think about frame, painting, window versus the screen, monitor, display. If the symbolic significance of perspective is based on the process of a fully perspectival view of space, when the entire picture has been transformed into a window, and when we are meant to believe we are looking through these windows into a space, the video operates instead as a space that requires to be looked into itself. The frame painting window, symbolizing the perspective universe, is as an inclusive space, all-embracing medium that tends to normalize and bring order to the chaos. Videomorphosis, as represented by the screen monitor display, acts by excluding, by cutting, thus proceeding in the opposite direction, from order to chaos. Therefore, while the theoretical approach of perspective culture is built on the concept of representation, the foundation of videomorphic culture is reification, from Latin word res, that means thing. The perspective vision implies the transformation of one thing into an image. One thing into an image. The videomorphic vision implies an image becoming a thing. This is one of the essential meaning of the videomorphosis process. That is the above mentioned connection between symbolic culture and material culture in our age. Images today explain what continental philosophy has called reification. So we can summarize as a reversal tendency. No more the reality that is represented through the images. No more things, pieces of reality, which becomes images, but images that becomes things. We can call it a visual reification. Images that become things. I will show you an example of this one reification. Look at this picture. In the 60s,
when video art was talking his first steps, when artists like Foster or Nam June Paik were beginning to reflect on the effects of television, they turned TV images into something looking as objects. We call this one as a video installation. In this kind of work, it's not important the message, but the medium. With their works, the several video artists, more or less voluntarily, especially in the 60s and the 70s, give shape to this transformation. They create new things from images. It's interesting to underline briefly that one of the first Nam June Paik's work is directly inspired by Marshall McLuhan. I'm referring to McLuhan Cage, an installation in which the picture of Marshall McLuhan, the face of Marshall McLuhan, is modified by a magnet, by Nam June Paik. So we can say the medium is the magnet. Okay, the comparison between perspective and videomorphic cultures will not be complete without another oppositional couple expressed by sequentiality versus simultaneity. Come back to McLuhan. McLuhan is well known for having indicated the technological material context where the printing process was developed as the epiphanic moment of the perspective culture. In fact, he has underlined that specific contribution given by the printing medium to the collective acceptance of the symbolic values inherent in the visual canons of perspective space. The linearity, sequentiality, seriality, uniformity of the printed page, together with the whole set of material values related to the so-called Gutenberg galaxy, appear to be perfectly attuned to the expression of the Renaissance Weltanschauung, the vision of the world, that gave birth to the perspective. As McLuhan explained, the printed book intensified perspective and the fixed point of view, associated with the visual stress on point of view and the vanishing point that provides the illusion of perspective, there comes another illusion that space is visual, uniform and continuous. The symbolic value of sequentiality in the perspective culture find its counterpart in the simultaneity, that is the primary element of the electronic galaxy. It is therefore, in McLuhan's term, as a cold medium, that is an highly participative medium like television. Simultaneity and participation are the quintessential expression of the videomorphosis process. Let's go on. The comparison between the two symbolic universes I'm considering here, perspective culture, so modern age, and videomorphic culture, so contemporary age, is also supported by several other antinomies, such as natural vision versus artificial vision, or manual skills versus mechanical skills, or even figuration versus abstractions. Perspective painting is intrinsically related to the idea of natural vision, while this relation does not necessarily apply in the case of video. The geometric principle of perspective aims to the reconstruction of a visual experience. The video, instead, is a visual experience in itself, not constrained by figuration, not all. Another antinomy is distance versus proximity. Distance is one of the symbolic values related to the perspective culture. Proximity represents an essential value of video morphosis. Just as detaching oneself from one object and approaching it are two opposite actions. The strategy of detachment, the world seen from far away, the vanishing point as a perspective main element, and its counterpart in the approaching strategy inherent in video, the world seen from up close, in full scale, or even the intrusion that looks for the detail, the foreground, the zoom, the visual fragment, the pixel. We can find something quite similar in the empathic and relational dimension expressed by the definition of vision or haptic space introduced by German philosopher Alois Riegel. Haptic, from the Latin word hapto, to touch, touching, as opposed to traditional optical vision. Haptic space implied a vision that can even touch and establish a contact surface, that is highly interactive, exploratory, penetrating. With regard to this, we could quote French philosophers Deleuze and Guattari, who insist on the distinction between close touching vision, haptic, and disembodied distant vision, optic. And it's interesting to quote here their terminological clarification. Haptic is a better word than tactile, since it does not establish an opposition between two sense organs, but rather invites the assumption that the eye itself may fulfill this monoptical function. Haptic is a new way of looking. For example, French media theorist Régis Debray has also chosen entry and sharing as fundamental values of the new media environment, which marks Debray the end of societal spectacle. We use it to be in front of the image, now we are in the visual. The term landscape was related to the eye and the term environment was related to the ear. Now the visual has become an almost resounding atmosphere, while the hands in the landscape is a synesthetic and embracing environment. The synesthetic vocation of video morphosis and its several expressions is explained within the field of phenomenology. For example, French philosopher Maurice Merleau-Ponty talked about a reciprocal subsistence of the tactile and visual spheres. He wrote, "La vision is palpation par la regard. Vision is palpation with the look." Or also, vision is as a palpation of the high. Merleau-Ponty wrote. So, Merleau-Ponty seems to suggest to decree the end of the visual perception's hegemony in favor of a plural, global, embracing involvement of the senses. Think about all of today's technological devices, like a smartphone or a laptop, are used by means of a prensil or tactile acoustic visual experience, as well as a synesthetic experience. We use our hands and our eyes, not only eyes. These technological devices form an hybrid surface that needs to be completed, touched, interacted with, and it services us at a sensorial rather than cognitive level. This is a crux point. It's an evolution from the idea of the visual landscape to that of sound, tactile, corporeal environment. We are back in acoustic space. Explained Marsh McLuhan in Counterblast in 1969. Following McLuhan, the acoustic space has a particular tactile corporeal value, capable of directly touching the skin or even reach the nerve endings. The acoustic space means the implication of the entire perceptive network. A new space of the contemporary age, a space of synesthesia. It is the theater of a real perceptive holism, a pan-aesthetic, because everything is networked with everything. As well as our senses are directly networked with everything. Because media system is an environment where everything is networked with everything. Here is one of the meanings of McLuhan's idea, we are back in acoustic space. And also the idea of the media ecology, media as environment. So, this last passage leads us back to the key concept of videomorphosis process and the assumption that forms the core of this my lecture. If we accept that video is the prevailing symbolic form of the contemporary age, I would suggest that the idea of videomorphosis, as the word itself seems suggest, implies an evolution, a transformation of the visual sense. I would say that the visual, the eye, the look, is just a gateway to the other senses. Video today has a medium, it's not just about the head. It does not concern only the visual. Through the visual, through the head, the entire sensory network, the full perceptive sphere, the whole sensorium is involved. And when the whole sensorium is involved, we can talk about a real aesthetic experience. At this regard, we must not forget that aesthetics should be understood as the full use of perceptive powers, perceptive network. A use allowing a kind of knowledge that is enhanced by implication of the entire sensorial network. And when we talk about aesthetics, we automatically acknowledge the essential contribution that the senses, along with the mind, give to knowledge. Senses and mind. Therefore, as explained by Marshall McLuhan, video as a medium, as a meta-medium of contemporary age, represents both chaos and effect. It is both the result, the effect of an extension, an enhancement of the sensorial powers, and the process, the causes, shaping them, the process that massage the collective sensorial sphere, either numbing or stimulating it, as the case may be. So, if video device extends, enhances our senses, at the same time, the video device change, modify ourselves, our way of looking, our vision of the world, our Weltanschauung. Ultimately, video forms, affects, changes who we are. In the light of this one, it's right what the American artist Peter Campus, a pioneer of video art, seems to have captured in 1999 with his brilliant expression. Video ergo sum. That sounds laconically as we are what we see. Thank you.